un sema.
Luego, sí.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, sir. Shall we start? Because two or 1 or 2 minutes we can wait.
We can wait for 1 or 2 minutes. Around 22 participants has already joined. I'll update you.
Good afternoon, sir.
Hello, how are you?
Hi, sir.
Good afternoon,
so nice to see you after so long.
Good afternoon.
So shall we start, sir?
I'm ready.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. How are you?
I'm fine, sir.
Thanks for yesterday. Your contribution was immense.
Thank you, sir.
So it is 2:25. I think we can start now to be on time.
So hi, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Dr. Seema Matodekar. On behalf of SOHOT and HOCC, would like to extend my warm welcome to all of you at 15th Hematology Update Vadodara. It gives me immense pleasure to welcome all distinguished and knowledgeable delegates, respected seniors, colleagues, and medical students from different medical colleges who have joined this webinar, I know, with the great enthusiasm. We have kept this annual meeting this time for 2 days, and day one, there are 4 presentations relevant to current day-to-day practice scenario. And on day two, there are 2 case-based panel discussions to encourage more and more interaction between faculty and panelists. One more attraction this year is quiz, for which we have registered almost 9 teams. It is indeed an honor to welcome today's faculty, Dr. M.B. Agarwal, who is renowned hematologist from Mumbai, born teacher, and everyone knows he is a father figure in the field of hematology. It is my privilege to welcome my mentor, Dr. Shashi Apte from Sahyadri Specialty Hospital, Pune, who is a taskmaster, and I know he has a great art of making difficult to understand subject very easy and crystal clear. It is great pleasure to offer the most hospitable welcome to Dr. Alurkar from Apollo Hospital, Ahmedabad, who is known for his depth of knowledge and is very popular among the DND students. Once again, I welcome all to the 15th Hematology Update Vadodara. And now let us have an inauguration of meeting. And we will initiate our scientific meeting with prayer.
Mahatanya, Maha.
Thank you, Dr. Bide, for auspicious prayer before starting meeting. And as all the participants who are attending this meeting since inception, they know that always Dr. M.D. Agarwal is the opening batsman of our meeting, and he is like a patron. And because of his inspiration and his guidance, we are going ahead with such kind of meeting annually, every year, in spite of the many hurdles. Like last year, it was too much for pandemic, but in spite of that, because of the inspiration from M.B. Agarwal, I did the digital. And this year also, there was a plan to make it hybrid, but because situation was not very clear and unpredictable, we decided to continue it virtual this year also. But I promise, if things are okay, next year definitely we will be meeting in person. And now I invite Dr. M.B. Agarwal, Professor and Head Department of Hematology, Bombay Hospital Institute of Medical Science, Consultant Hematology, Lilavati Hospital, Bishkandi, President, Mumbai Hematology Group. Everyone knows that Hematology Group, Mumbai, every week, there's a good presentation and good academic activity is happening just because of the inspirational force of Dr. M.B. Agarwal. So, and he was past president of Indian Society of Hematology and Transfusion Medicine. Over to you, Dr. M.B. Agarwal. Everybody is eager to hear from you, thrombosis, post-infection, and post-COVID vaccination.
Thank you, Dr. Seema. I'll just share my screen. Okay, so first of all, I'm grateful to Dr. Seema for her kind words and also for involving me in her yearly very, very prestigious CME of Vadodara Hematology Group. My subject today is, I've slightly modified it, when I clotted after taking COVID-19 vaccine. Let me tell you the case, and I must tell you that this case was very challenging because when this happened, no one knew anything about this entity. Satvinder Kaur, 32 years, moved to London early this year. She noticed unbearable headache. She managed it with paracetamol for a day or two. However, she developed a seizure and then had to be hospitalized, and she was admitted to the King's College London. Imaging showed superior sagittal sinus thrombosis, and blood investigation showed that the platelet count was 42,000 per cubic millimeter. It was at this stage that one of her relatives and a very dear friend of mine, an orthopedic surgeon from Mumbai, he contacted me. He said, this is what has happened to one of his relatives who had just gone to London, this is what she has been admitted for. He wanted me to talk to the local hematologist, and fortunately the hematologist was a dear friend. She spoke to me. She said that yes, this Indian lady is admitted with her, and for headache, when they did the imaging, she found the superior sagittal sinus thrombosis and the platelet count is low. And she mentioned that the combination of this, she is thinking of that this may be a DIC-like process or a thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura-like process or an antiphospholipid syndrome or something like HIT, heparin-induced thrombocytopenia with thrombosis. These are four conditions in hematology which produce low platelet count and not bleeding but thrombosis. She wasn't exactly clear what it is out of this particular condition, and she asked me to contact her after a day or two. When I contacted her after 48 hours, she mentioned that there are many developments in this patient. On her round, she found that her spleen was palpable. And because of that, she ordered for a sonography and Doppler. And to her surprise, the portal vein and splenic vein were also thrombosed. So this young lady had thrombosis at two sites, brain and in the splenic vessel. She also found that her fibrinogen level was low and the D-dimer was high. She didn't find any cystocytes or the fragmented RBC to think of thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura. The workup for antiphospholipid syndrome was negative. There wasn't any history of heparin at all. So she said this is probably some kind of form thruster of disseminated intravascular coagulation, but she can't figure it out as there is hardly anything as the primary event to have resulted into DIC. After another day or two, when we talked, she said there is one more development. And that development is that this lady had taken her COVID vaccine first dose after coming to London, and just about 2 weeks prior to this neurological and abdominal episode. She also mentioned that the husband was also vaccinated on the same day and he's fine. The indigenous vaccine in London is the Oxford vaccine, which is same as AstraZeneca, which is an adenovirus based vaccine, but is in India, is produced by Serum Institute. Another development was that a day later, patient became unconscious and hemiplegic, and a repeat imaging showed that she had a venous hemorrhage in the brain. She required ventilation. By now, the hematologist became tight-lipped. When I contacted her again, she said, this is a little problem. I cannot go on sharing the data from the patient because this is confidential. And now, with this background of vaccine, there could be legal issues involved. They had not seen anything like this in their department, but when they contacted their colleagues all around, she came to know about few patients in London and in UK who had developed intracranial thrombosis following the Oxford vaccine. She requested me not to speak about it because this is all on confidential. The way back somewhere in February, March this year. Subsequently, this patient was treated with IV gamma globulin to improve her platelet count, whatever may be the mechanism of low platelet. And she was given injection fondaparinux for her clots in the brain and in the abdomen. Subsequently, about 6 weeks after her admission, fortunately for the patient, she was discharged with complete recovery from her hemiplegia, headache, and abdominal symptoms. Quite some time has gone, February, and now we are in November. And by now, we know a lot about what had happened to this lady and what we should know in medical community. This entity is now named. And the name given to this entity is vaccine-induced thrombosis with thrombocytopenia. Many of you must be aware of heparin-induced thrombosis with thrombocytopenia, what is called HIT with double T. So this is called VIT, vaccine-induced thrombosis with thrombocytopenia. Now, overall, vaccination against COVID-19 is of extreme importance. In UK, a single dose of vaccine reduced hospitalization and death by 80%. In USA, single and double doses of vaccination, irrespective of which brand it may be, the hospitalization reduced by 65% after single dose and 95% after double dosing. So the global immunization against COVID-19 is a remarkable medical achievement, and which the medical fraternity and the researchers and the scientists are very proud of. Overall, the vaccination against COVID-19 is extremely safe, not safe, extremely safe. However, occasionally, one can get complication with a serious side effect. And one of them is this, VITT, thrombosis with thrombocytopenia. How common is this VITT? We don't know. But one thing is for sure, that it is rare. Anything which is rare, if the index cases are in millions, then the number of cases could be in hundreds. And that is what has happened, because the vaccination that has been done against COVID-19 is now not in billions, but in billions. As a result of which, several hundred patients have developed VITT. Now let's summarize the clinical picture of this entity. And this one cartoon summarizes everything. History of adenovirus-based vaccine. Incidence of 1 in 30,000 to 1 in 100,000. Shown over here in red, out of large number of people who received the vaccine. Somewhere after as early as 5th day and maybe as late as 30th day, develop low platelet count and symptoms suggestive of thrombosis. Most commonly in the brain, can be splanchnic and can be anywhere. And this one cartoon explains you the total clinical profile of VITT. So which are these adenovirus-based vaccine? Oxford vaccine, AstraZeneca Serum Institute is the one which is most widely used. And the second one is Johnson & Johnson, used reasonably extensively in USA till they brought a halt and then again permitted it to be used. This Johnson & Johnson vaccine is a single dose vaccine, while the one from Oxford AstraZeneca Serum Institute are two doses. Now, if you look at this entity of cortical venous thrombosis, in general population, the incidence is 0.4 per million. With mRNA vaccine, there are cases, but very, very few, 4 per million, both Pfizer and Moderna. With AstraZeneca, this number goes up fivefold, 20 per million. And this is much less than what you can happen with COVID-19 infection itself, which you know is a prothrombotic infection leading to thrombi in various parts of the body, and the cortical venous thrombosis incidence is 39 per million. This study finally was published by the hematologist whom I spoke to in New England Journal in August. Our case was somewhere in February, March. And she published this data in August in NEJM. The median days after the vaccination was 14, somewhere over here. So it occurs early, from fifth day to at the most 30 days. Same kind of data from US J&J vaccine. The median was after about 10 days and could happen as early as 3 days to as late as 15 days. The age distribution, by now we know that COVID-19 produces maximum thrombi in elderly people. Well, this is different. The vaccine-induced thrombi occurred in young people with a median of 48, somewhere here. And if you see the whole histogram, as the age advances, the chance of this thrombosis reduces. And same thing was noted in US by Johnson vaccine. The median was 39 years. So young people get thrombi much more than the elderly people who get thrombi following COVID infection itself. Females outnumber males, which was not so with COVID-19. COVID-19 infection produced thrombi with equal incidence in males and females, while vaccine led to about ratio of 70 to 30. Females outnumber males. What were the sites of thrombi? If you remember, COVID-19 infection led to thrombi basically in the leg veins, DVT and pulmonary embolism. That was the commonest presentation even today. While vaccine-induced thrombi, the commonest site is cortical, brain. And that can lead to cortical venous sinus thrombosis and then venous hemorrhage, like what you see over here. So that's a real patient's data showing you superior sagittal sinus thrombosis and a venous hemorrhage on the right side. This is a post-mortem data from USA of a patient where superior sagittal sinus has been opened up, showing you the clot. And this clot under the microscope shows a large amount of red cells and fibrin. This is another case published from Czechoslovakia. That's spleen. Portal vein got thrombosed, splenic vein got thrombosed, spleen got engorged, it enlarged and it ruptured. And because of that, what you see in black here is the subcapsular hematoma around the spleen, marked by the solid arrows. And what you see over here is intra-abdominal, between the liver and the diaphragm, fluid lying there. Same patient, once again, you can see the spleen, which is engorged and large. You can see the subcapsular hematoma. In addition, what you can see is the portal vein, which is thrombosed. And there is collection of fluid in the abdominal cavity between liver and the diaphragm. And this is an angiographic study, as well as the clot that was removed. And as you can see over here, the asterisk indicates the portal vein thrombosis. That's the splenic vein, that's the portal vein, that's superior mesenteric vein, that's the left and the right portal vein. And what you see over here is an angiogram, which is done after removal of the clot, thrombectomy, which was done, and you can see almost total patency of the portal vein. Not that you cannot get leg vein thrombus. This is a patient who got leg vein thrombus. By now, we have 11 patients in Mumbai. This is one leg vein thrombosis. And this can go to the lung and produce pulmonary embolism. And you see over here, the left pulmonary artery showing the thrombus. And that's the thrombus that was removed by thrombectomy. It's not only the venous side, but you can get arterial thrombi, and this is descending aorta showing the clot, and that's the clot that has been reported. And it can affect small vessels. As you see, ischemic changes in the hands, which have got cyanosed, and the toes, which have become reddish. So this is going back to the NEJM publication by Sui Pevor. The cortical venous thrombosis is the highest. Pulmonary arteries are here, portal veins, splanchnic vein over here, and multiple sites is here. So cortical vein, splanchnic vein, multiple sites, pulmonary are the commonest. And nothing is immune. Any vein or artery can be involved, as you see at the bottom. Now in this entity, the platelets go down invariably after the vaccine. The platelet go down and there is a thrombus. Think of VITT. And you can get purpuric spots. Frank bleeding is not seen, neither in the UK series, not in our small series. Median platelet count is 47,000, as you see over here. This is publication of Sue Peward. Is 47,000 median platelet count. Fibrinogen level drops and the median is 120 milligram. Somewhere over here is the median. And the D-dimer is raised 24,000 somewhere over here. So lab combination is low platelet, D-dimer and fibrinogen. By now we know the pathogenesis of this entity, which we didn't know when Satvinder Kaur got it. So this has been now clearly shown by more than one study that this is an immune-mediated complication following the vaccine, occurring 5 to 30 days after the vaccine. And the antibody is against platelet factor 4. Remember heparin? Heparin produces antibody against platelet factor 4. Exactly the same thing. The vaccine is producing antibody against platelet factor 4. So thrombus due to COVID-19 infection is a different disease, and the same due to vaccine is a different disease. When you get it due to infection itself, it is a consumptive coagulopathy together with endotheliopathy. So this is a beautiful cartoon from Blood Journal telling you that the VITT is antiplatelet factor 4 antibody, while COVID-19 is an antibody against the virus, which is the culprit. COVID infection does many things. We all know it leads to vasoplasia, ARDS, myocardial injury, immune exhaustion, and here is what we are talking about. It produces thromboembolism. So finally, how do you diagnose in your practice a patient has taken vaccine? And how do you diagnose that this patient has developed VITT? So this patient who has taken a vaccine, which is adenovirus based, so Covishield in India, comes to you 5 to 30 days after the vaccine, and she's a female and she's young. Male can be 1/3 and other groups can be a small number, but mostly around 40s and 50s. Comes to you for what? Comes to you with either headache or abdominal pain, which you can't explain. Or it could be even more than headache and vomiting. Or like seizure in our patient. Our patient may become unconscious or may become hemiplegic. So any neurological symptom. Similarly, in the abdomen, it can be severe abdominal pain mimicking an acute abdomen. On examination, you may notice some bruises or purpuric spot. And there is no background of prothrombotic condition which can cause thrombosis. So normally in a hematological practice, somebody comes for thrombosis, you take this history, OC pills, hormonal therapy, predisposing factor on the arterial side like obesity, hypertension, diabetes, IHD, or genetic prothrombotic disorders like antithrombin 3, protein C, protein S, factor 5. Now you find none of these in the history. So this is the profile of a patient by which you suspect that this could be VITT. So then you should go to the lab. And the first test, simplest test, is the CBC, showing you that the platelet count has dropped. If there is no thrombocytopenia, there is no VITT. Now, if the platelet count has dropped, the next two tests are the low fibrinogen and the raised D-dimer. And if you get this combination, you are almost on the verge of diagnosis, which you can confirm by doing this less commonly available test, the antiplatelet factor 4 antibody positivity by ELISA or functional assay. In Mumbai, we have it at multiple hospitals available, and with this vaccine induced thrombosis with thrombocytopenia, now there are about a dozen hospitals who have set up this test. They didn't do it for it, but they had to do this because of the COVID vaccine, because everybody takes vaccine, somebody gets headache, somebody's got thrombus somewhere, somebody's platelet is low, you need this test now. And of course, you do imaging to confirm your diagnosis that the headache is due to CVT and abdominal pain is due to SVT. What's the prognosis of this entity? Bad. This is not something you can pass off. This is a bad prognostic disease. This is Jonathan Cotino writing that though this is a rare condition, but it's a very severe condition with very high rate of coma and a very high rate of intracerebral hemorrhage. So this is a morbid complication with high fatality. The case fatality rate is 1 out of 5. So though it's a rare condition, but once you get it, there's a problem. And those who get hemorrhage, and that can happen in 26.5 to 75% of patients, then death can occur in 3 out of 4. And the commonest cause of such high morbidity and mortality is that we didn't know much about this entity. Like in the COVID last year, a lot of morbidity mortality occurred, and now that is significantly reduced and patients can be managed at home. Today, we know about this vaccine-induced complication, so you can diagnose them on minimum symptoms, minimum signs, do the specific investigation, start the treatment. So this is the historical, that means 9 months data only, but the historical overall mortality 22%. And if you've got intracranial hemorrhage, 73%. So last part, how do you manage this entity? This is three color coding. There are 6 statements on this slide, 2 in black, 2 in red, 2 in magenta. The first 2 in black is what not to do. Because the pathogenesis is similar to HIT, refrain from giving heparin, including low molecular weight heparin as the treatment of cortical venous thrombosis or splenic venous thrombosis. I mean, this is something which is the first thing to be done in the mid of night when a patient is admitted with thrombi. But if it is VITT, don't do this. Platelet is low, person has got bruises. The next thing you do is order for the platelet. Please don't do that. Like HIT, this is adding fuel to the fire. So don't give platelet, don't give heparin. And what do? Give non-heparin anticoagulant. My baby is fondaparinux, and many are using rivaroxaban or apixaban oral compounds, but I prefer to inject. And for the platelet, use the master, expensive but master substance, IV gamma globulin, because that's the fastest way to improve the platelet without increasing the risk of thrombi. So anticoagulate and improve the platelet. If the patient is bad, and I showed you some example, do mechanical thrombectomy. And sometimes you may have such low fibrinogen that you may have to replace it. So you can replace it with fibrinogen concentrate, and now we have indigenously made fibrinogen concentrate, or cryo as the source of fibrinogen, or even plasma as the source of fibrinogen. Or desperate measure in a person who is deteriorating, do plasma exchange to remove these antibodies. This is a publication again in August, New England Journal. Immunoglobulin for vaccine-induced ITT. It took time. I mean, our early cases, we gave steroids, but now we know the jump straight to IV gamma globulin. And this is combination of IV gamma globulin prednisolone in 4 patients, patient 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 rather, showing how the platelet count improves from very low after giving IV gamma globulin prednisolone. This is Ishak summarizing the treatment. IV gamma globulin together with anticoagulant gives you a successful management of these patients. So this is my flow chart to tell you the summary of what I spoke to you. So you get a patient She's in her 30s and 40s or 50s, female more than male. Within 3 weeks of taking an adenovirus-based vaccines, you do a CBC, you do a D-dimer, and you do fibrinogen. They're normal. VITT is ruled out. It shows only low platelet. VITT is ruled out, but this is vaccine-induced ITP. And you get all three, then this is VITT. Get the imaging done, show that there are thrombi, and get the so-called HIT test for platelet factor 4 done, which will stamp the diagnosis. Irrespective of the thrombus, hospitalize the patient. Treat with non-heparin anticoagulant, IV gamma globulin, until the platelet count normalizes. We have given sometimes in one patient 2 courses of 5 days of IV gamma globulin, and of course, anticoagulation has been continued for a long period. Switching from fondaparinux next to DOIX. So by now, we have many knowns, but still there are many unknowns. And if I list you, what are the unknowns first? When you say that this happens to 1 out of 100,000 patients, is there a genetic susceptibility? We don't have an answer to this. Are there biomarkers to suspect who will develop this complication or to make an early diagnosis? We do not have these biomarkers. When I say this, I'll come back in my next slide, what we do today. Which component of the vaccine is responsible so that you can seal off this complication totally? We don't know. Is it the DNA cargo? Is it contaminants? Is it adenovirus vector itself? We don't know. How can we fine-tune the treatment? Who requires IV gamma? Who requires fondaparinux? Who requires both? Who requires plasma? Who requires plasma exchange? Who requires thrombectomy? Do we have guidelines? We don't. Should adenovirus vaccines be avoided as the second dose if this has happened after first? Logic answer is yes, but we have data we don't have. And now that we are talking of boosters, suppose this happens after second dose, do we give boosters? We don't know. If this patient tomorrow undergoes dialysis after 10 years, or he undergoes open heart surgery, can heparin be used? We don't know. So these are unknowns. But what we know, a lot of information in these 9 months. Tremendous, isn't it? February to November, and the amount of data we have collected. So first case, February 2022, 9 months, and we have learned the epidemiology, female, young, adenovirus vaccine, 5 to 30 days. Pathogenesis, platelet factor 4 antibody. Clinical picture, thrombi anywhere, venous, arterial, commonest, brain, commonest, splenic. Few purpura bruises. Lab diagnosis, platelet, fibrinogen, D-dimer, platelet factor 4. Management, IV gamma globulin, fondaparinux. We have understood all of this. And what's most important is, and I think it, part of my this talk today is to increase the awareness of this entity in the medicos, right from GP to internist to the super specialist and the COVID doctors. Quick suspicion, unexplained sudden headache after vaccine. Yeah, you can manage with Dolo, you can manage with Crocin, you can manage with paracetamol, but be careful. Early diagnosis, effective treatment, morbidity and mortality can be reduced. As I mentioned, we have now personal experience of 11 cases. Fortunately, these are our cases in the second half of this year, so we had a lot of data to read about and discuss with our colleagues from abroad. We have lost only 2 patients. 9 have survived. And this is what I was talking about, that what we are doing today. This is a term which I have coined, and I've sent a letter to Lancet, and I hope they publish, pre-VITT syndrome. They may not publish because this is more of hypothesis than a proof. Now, what is pre-VITT syndrome? What I'm proposing is that if a patient within a month of taking adenovirus-based vaccine comes to you with low platelet count, and that's a common scenario in hematology practice. Platelet count has dropped. It could be just totally unrelated to vaccine, but somebody has come to you with so-called ITP, but there's a history of vaccine within 1 month. This person's, if D-dimer is high and fibrinogen is low, the person has got no thrombosis anywhere in the body. I would like to treat this patient with IV gamma globulin and anticoagulate this patient. And this is what I say, that I have diagnosed pre-VITT. No thrombosis has taken place. The only background is vaccine, low platelet, but with that low platelet, there is a D-dimer and fibrinogen. And I can't document clot anywhere. There is no symptom, there is no sign, there is no imaging. And should I start treatment at this stage? That's what I have proposed and written the letter. Let's hope it gets accepted, and let's hope people generate some data on this basis. Rare is rare. These are common complications of Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine. This is a study published of 100 and odd cases. And if you look at the various complications that have been listed here, VITT does not feature, obviously, because this is just 133 patients. So you've got ITP there, yes, but not VITT. No side effects, only 9%. Headache, soreness at the site, aching joints, flu-like symptoms, fatigue. So these are all there. So we tell all our patients, isn't it? Don't bother. One day, 2 days, everything goes away. Take rest, take paracetamol, fine. So this is all treatable by paracetamol, and ITP, of course, we can handle. So these are side effects, which are all minor side effects. Now, overall blood clots after COVID-19 is rare. So COVID infection, 16.5% incidence of clot. Smoking, almost 0.2% incidence. Birth control pill, 0.05 to 0.12. AstraZeneca vaccine, 0.0004% vaccine. So rare. And if you look at young people and old people, and if you look at the death by coronavirus and serious harm due to vaccine, compare the two. Death by coronavirus in elderly people, 800 per million. But serious side effect of vaccine, 4 per million. Where is the comparison? Why should one be scared of taking vaccine? Young people, little vitiated, 23, so less die due to corona, young people, and more get complication due to vaccine. So the lesson still is, before you get a bit biased that, oh, vaccine is bad, vaccinate. COVID-19 vaccination is mandatory, and there is no need to talk about, this is my body, this is my life, I'll do what I want. Then remain at home, because you are a source of death of other people if you are not vaccinated. And that should not be and must not be permitted. And that's my lady, Satvinder Kaur, and her family back to routine, normal life in London. Thank you so much. And once again, thanks to Seema for giving this opportunity to speak to you.
Thank you, sir, for making this topic again easy to understand. I have one question. That you have shown the data, slide of data, which has shown that younger patients, like between 30 to 40 years of age, have a more incidence of thrombosis related to post-vaccine. So I just wanted to know, even though the data is not showing any genetic predisposition, there is no increase in rate in the elderly. So is it? Usually, what we see in a genetic predisposition, less than 40 years, whenever there is a thrombosis, there is a correlation. Maybe that is a underlying increase susceptibility, and that vaccine-induced immune reaction is the trigger. And with that, something else is also trigger. I do not know about the how many patients have been evaluated. Means they must have evaluated. But I don't know the data about what was their genetic predisposition data. And that is what is has been asked in one of question answer. Dr. Amay Kurane has asked for what data says about how many patients were having genetic predisposition. And secondly, regarding females also, what I feel, maybe like you coined the term pre-VVIT syndrome, like maybe females having pre-APLA kind of some tendency, and that has created this kind of thrombosis.
Okay, so Seema, first of all, answering your second question first. So before this VITT term was sort of coined and the entity was understood, APLA workup was left and right because thrombosis with thrombocytopenia. Yes. As I showed in the last sentence of my slide, my patient, first week we were discussing about DIC versus APLA versus TTP versus heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. Those were the four conditions which produce in your routine hematology practice thrombi with thrombocytopenia. So APLA workup has been done for most of the patients. And if you read this peer-reviewed article in New England Journal, APLA data is there. The genetic predisposition, now that workup is being done, but not published, not presented as yet. But the, you know, in North European, there is extremely high incidence of factor V laden and prothrombin mutation. So there is a feeling by Sui Pavard and her group, and this data that she's published from 11 institutions from Great Britain, there is a feeling that there is absolutely no difference in the incidence of factor V laden or prothrombin mutation in this group versus those who did not thrombose. And with now that platelet factor 4 like mechanism has been documented, so we know the pathogenesis. We just do not know what predisposes one individual over the other. Lastly, about your age distribution. What happened, you know, after this initial data that elderly people get thrombi. You know, vaccine data came later on, the disease is producing thrombi in elderly people. And that you see left and right, that elderly people die of corona much more than the young people. Many countries sort of did not give a vaccine which can keep, can cause thrombi to elderly people. So the data also is a bit vitiated that now the index cases are more young than older. Like for example, Canada. Canada licensed AstraZeneca vaccine only for people under the age of 65. They banned it above the 65. It's possible that if it was given to an equal number of people who are elderly, you could have got the age distribution very differently. So, you know, with evolving science, a lot of things can change. What I have presented today is publication of August.
Yes.
It must have been written in June to get published in August. So it is a data of, say, February to June. And maybe in the next major conference, you will have an update on this.
So there is one question from gynecologist that she is an IVF specialist, Dr. Sushma Bakshi from Baroda. She's asking, after vaccination, can we start the treatment for IVF? IVF treatment includes the giving higher doses of hormones, and does vaccination put them to the higher risk?
I think by again logic, I would answer that just avoid the first month. Because all this has happened in the first month after vaccination. So IVF will remain the standard treatment. This complication is rare, and fortunately, it has happened in the first month. So vaccination, second dose over, wait for a month, go for the IVF.
I think Shashi wants to ask him.
Yes, Shashi.
I just want to make a comment to your question, Seema.
Yes.
If you look at heparin-induced thrombosis, thrombocytopenia entity, the generally genetic conditions are negative. That data is published. So if we say ki VITT is similar to HITT, probably let the data mature. Probably, I think it may be independent of your genetic predisposition.
It is possible, but just because I saw that 40 years and less, that was my thinking.
Oh, Seema, I mean, you are not far away. If you read antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, there's so much of data on underlying antithrombin 3, protein C, protein S, factor V laden. So one still is not very clear, but there is data that you have this, then you get more thrombi. So thrombosis is always multifactorial.
Yes.
As is the standard teaching. Bleeding is one factor, hemophilia. thrombocytopenia, but thrombosis is multifactorial. You have antithrombin 3 deficiency on top of that factor 5 laden, on top of
then
that.
It goes acting together.
You take OC pill or you do IVF, then you get the clot.
Yeah. So, and last question, sir.
Yeah.
Arterial thrombosis. How do you treat arterial thrombosis in such a situation?
So arterial thrombosis, besides anticoagulation, you'll end up with thrombectomy because you know you're developing ischemic insult to the part of the body. So invariably you go for, wherever it is possible, a vascular surgeon will do a thrombectomy. And of
antiplatelet, course, rule of antiplatelet?
Yeah, I mean, arterial antiplatelet, venous anticoagulation, that is all standard, but thrombectomy.
Thrombectomy is the. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you once again for inviting me.
Thank you, sir.
So now we will move forward for a second presentation by none other than my mentor, Dr. Shashi Apte. For those who do not know, he is known figure in India, but for those who do not know, he is MD from KM Hospital, Mumbai, and he has been trained in CMC Vellore and FRCPA from Westmed, Australia, and now practicing as a hematologist, onco-hematologist, and BMT physician at Sahyadri Specialty Hospital, Pune. He is going to talk on systemic manifestation of hematological disorder. So I gave him a little bit difficult topic because I know he is my teacher and he can make the things easier for us to understand. It's not, I have not asked him to say that like renal failure, look for myeloma, or convulsion, look for TTP, or bone pain, look for ALL. I want to hear from him what is the pathophysiology or how our thinking should go for whenever we see the systemic manifestation. And what are the clues based on which we should think about the hematological disorder? Dr. Shashi Apte, over to you.
Thank you, Seema. I'll just share my slides. Can you see the slide, Seema?
Yes.
So thank you, Seema, for inviting me again for your webinar. You really gave me a tough topic, and when you gave me a topic, I went into this position for a long time. I was thinking, what should be done? And then I tried to make some effort to answer your question, because we had a talk about this, how we should go about and what we should talk. So in next few slides, I'll try to expand. Some of the things are my thoughts, some of the things are documented, and I'll share with you all. So why hematological disorders have systemic manifestations? Because when I was thinking, I said, why it happens, how it happens, and when it happens. When to answer was very easy, it can happen anytime when the disorder sets in. But how and why are quite intriguing things, and I don't think I may have answered to the fullest, but I made a certain effort to answer these things. We must understand that blood is an unique organ in the body. It's an extremely unique organ. First and most important, it's a flowing organ. No other organ in the body flows inside the body. Your gastric cells are in your gastric mucosa. They are not floating in the renal system or hepatic system routinely. Whenever there is a malignancy, they go and deposit. But that's a different mechanism. As a normal system, normal organ, this is the only liquid organ that is there in the body as an organ. There are a lot of liquids in the body, but they are not organs. It comes in direct contact with other organs in physiological way and can come in contact in pathological way and can deposit onto the other organs at any given time. Dr. Agarwal's slide showed the blood vessel, and that was a fantastic thing. You can see how many things are there in a blood vessel. Even a minute vessel carries a plethora of entities. The cells that are carried by this organ have a direct biological impact. They are biological, all cells are biologically active. And because these cells are coming in contact with other active cell, it is going to have a biological impact and it is going to cause the systemic manifestation. We must understand the hematological organ cells are rapidly dividing cellular component. You cut the stomach in any surgery, no new stomach originates. You do a hepatectomy, no new liver forms. So this is a unique organ which has a rapidly dividing cellular component and which can replenish whatever has been lost. Like you donate the blood, you have lost the organ, but again, you recover it. And that is very unique feature of blood as an organ. It causes cell-to-cell interaction with vascular endothelium. No other organ routinely has cell-to-cell interaction unless there is a immunological thing. Now, I'm not making this as a gospel statement. I'm sure they are interacting when the blood flows through it, but it is not the other way around. It is composed of extremely diverse components. And this diversity starts with cellular diversity. We have a variety of cells normally in the blood. They are of various sizes, various numbers, and their gaseous carriage capacity is different. And this is unique. All these things are constant in a other organ. And that makes blood quite a fascinating organ for me. There is a functional diversity. The function of neutrophil is different. Function of T cells is different. T cell has compartments, CD4, CD8, NK cells. Each cell has a different function and different diversity and still acts as a part of a single organ. I find this very fascinating. And there is plasma. There will be floating antigens, there will be floating antibodies. You have taken COVID vaccine, you have taken tetanus vaccine. Some immunological turbulence will happen and that will get reflected in human plasma. That never occurs in other organs. So change in quantity or quality of blood component leads to an imbalance and it is bound to affect the surrounding other organs and cause systemic manifestations. There is a book written by Dr. Winthrop. He is the son of Senior Winthrop who wrote the book. The name of the book is Blood Pure and Eloquent. It's a storytelling about hematology and it's a fascinating book to read. And some of these thoughts are from there. So by what mechanisms blood can impact other organs? It can be physical or mechanical impact. It can be biological impact. It can be chemical impact. It can be immunological impact and it can be combined impact. So when you sit back and think, oh my God, blood can impact in so many ways, I had not realized. And such diversity originates out of the uniqueness of blood. You won't have this kind of a diversity with other organs. And that, I think, is one of the major culprits or major mechanisms that causes systemic manifestations of hematological disorders. So when we talk of mechanical or physical impact, first is obviously the infiltration. You can imagine the cell numbers are rising. You can get a chloroma. Even in a case like CML, when the WBC count starts rising beyond 5 lakhs, you will start getting chloromas, even though when there is no blast crests. I'm talking of CML in CP. This physical impact will make the cells easily seep out of the vascular endothelium and deposit into the organs. When there is a change in plasma, or even when there is a cellular component change, there is going to be change in viscosity. There is going to be increase in viscosity. Take a simple example of polycythemia rubra vera. Polycythemia rubra vera, RBC start rising, viscosity changes and you get the impact of thrombosis. These thrombosis, as we can say, can be venous arterial small vessel disease and n number of disorders originate out of it. Whenever there is a marked increase in cellular components, as their quantity increases, the quality of the cells and the impact of these cells to affect the surrounding organ changes. And that also can cause a physical or a mechanical impact. And same thing can happen with plasma components. A sheer increase of plasma globulin, especially in something like Waldenstrom's, very high IgM level. All immunoglobulins are of different size. They are different molecular weights, but they live otherwise in harmony in the blood. But suppose you have a condition like Waldenstrom's, you will have very high levels of IgM, which has a high molecular weight, lot of viscous or rheological changes are going to happen. Firkov in 1881 had described this called what we know today as a Firkov's triad. And if you remember Firkov's triad, one was the vessel thrombus, viscosity, vessel wall, and the chemicals in the blood. Also, the hematological component can cause external compression. You can imagine there is a lymphatic tumor growing and it can cause SVC compression. You get SVC syndrome. It's a manifestation as swelling of the face. There can be the compression in the other organs. Once these viscosity changes, there is a decreased oxygen delivery to the tissues and there is a hypoxic changes at the cellular level. And all these things changes the fluid dynamics. We must understand the laws of physics will apply to any fluid dynamics and are applied to blood also. And overall, it's a quantitative impact. So I'll present the first case. It is a 27-year-old male patient admitted, a known alcoholic, was feeling unwell and noticed jaundice over a month. On examination, it was only jaundice and hepatosplenomegaly and ascites. And these were the investigations. He was referred to gastro team. He was very sick. You can see the bilirubin, presenting bilirubin. LDH was high, albumin was low. Triphasic CT scan and abdominal CT was done. We showed a complete hepatic and portal vein thrombosis. At this stage, immediately they started working for liver transplant because he was in really bad shape. The hemat team was involved to evaluate relatively low hemoglobin, high WBC count, and very high platelet count. We did the workup. It was bone marrow was consistent with MPN with 3x3 fibrosis. The patient had JAK2 positivity, MPL positivity, and BCR-ABL negativity. Cytogenetic score 46XY. The final diagnosis was made as Budd-Chiari syndrome with MPN. Immediately, the workup was done, and he underwent a live-related liver transplant. The sister is the donor. Post-transplant, the patient has been started on ruxolitinib and patient has been also given lifelong anticoagulation because there was a portal vein thrombosis and MPN is still present. Luckily, same sister is a 10x10 HLA match and we have counseled the family that this patient may need stem cell transplant at some later date because he is only 27-year-old male. Ruxolitinib-like drug has not shown a cure of MPN. So this case clearly represents that by sheer changes as well as by some other biological impacts, the primary presentation was hepatic. He just presented a jaundice. Alcoholic patient presenting with jaundice, things will say, come on, he's alcoholic, it is well known. But when you look at the hemogram, the liver team immediately involved the hematology team and we could reach to the diagnosis. And from admission, literally to the day 9th, he had undergone the liver transplant. Now he's following with both the OPDs. He's been well controlled with Jakavi. The counts have normalized. He's living a normal life. There is a small portal vein thrombosis still there, and he has been managed with rivaroxaban. We are waiting. We have counseled the family, and I'm sure sometime in future, he might need the stem cell transplant, unless some new wonder drug comes. Because we have seen that ruxolitinib has not really made that kind of an impact like imatinib made in CML. So primary myelofibrosis, MPN, still are the candidates for allogeneic stem cell transplant in coming days. But after the liver transplant, all these hepatic parameters have improved. He's living a normal life and is being followed. It was a real eye-opener, you know, means these guys, we have read, but it was a really, really acute kind of a presentation and a Badkeri syndrome. When we talk of biological impacts, there is a cell-to-cell interaction. This is a second mechanism which are going to cause the systemic manifestation. Hematopoietic cells are reacting with other organs. We know today in autoimmune conditions, there's a loss of self-recognition and they can impact. Then sometimes there's a primary hematopoietic malignancy and these malignant cells will have a biological impact to the neighboring organs or the wherever the blood is flowing to. We today know that malignant cells have a paracrine impact, that whatever cytokines, chemicals they release can impact the surrounding cells, and it also has an autocrine impact and it keeps the cells in circulation. Hemophagocytosis by macrophages is an unique phenomenon and it is a very lethal disease, HLH, and that happens sheerly because of the macrophage monocyte component attacking other organs which are otherwise living in harmony. Whenever these biological impacts happen, it leads to a lot of conglomeration, mixing of interleukins, cytokines, and most importantly, the antibody production. With these biological impacts, any organ, any system can get affected. So again, a hepatic presentation, but here, look at the age. She is a 3-year-old female child born of a consanguineous marriage. Unwell, noticed jaundice over a period of a month for the first time. She also had high fever on examination, marked pallor and jaundice and hepatosplenomegaly ascites. So barring for marked pallor and fever, this child had exactly similar presentation as the first case. But look at the investigations. The investigation showed hemoglobin of 4.2 grams, TLC of 200, platelet of 9,000. Bilirubin slightly lower. HGPT, HGOT was in very high range, so is the LDH. Creatinine was normal. The triphasic liver CT scan with abdominal CT was normal. Triple H, that is HIV, B and C was negative. Viruses were negative. Other hepatic viruses were negative. Ferritin was 12,600, very high triglyceride and low fibrinogen. We did a bone marrow showed hypocellular bone marrow with hemophagocytosis. Cytogenetics was normal. Looking at the age, we sent off the gene analysis and she came positive for FHLH2, that is perforin 1 gene mutation positive. And we made a final diagnosis of primary HLH. And immediately we counseled the family and she luckily had a sibling, which was a complete match. And the sibling is negative for FHLH2. The child is nearly 3 years post-transplant, 3 to 4 years post-transplant, doing well. Again, an example that this was not a hepatic disease, but again, the presentation was hepatic and there was a genetic component to it. So whenever we have these situations, whenever we have an organ involvement with pancytopenia, we have to rule out HLH. And these are the classification of HLH, which is a primary and secondary HLH. Secondary HLH is far, far more common. The commonest cause is bacteria, is the infections. Bacterial infections, tuberculosis, typhoid, viral infections are quite notorious. Second group of these HLH is well known with collagen vascular diseases and malignancy. And these are the 8 clinical features of HLH. The patient has to have at least 5 criteria, clinical criteria to call it a HLH. And the second cartoon shows the vicious cycle involved by hemophagocytic situation. Look at the chemical secreted. Look at the direct tissue injury caused by the cell. Look at the interplay with CD8 positive T cells. This is all biological impact combined with, this is not a physical impact. This is a pure biological impact. And this is the second group of disorders which can present with systemic manifestation. This is a case three. She is a 43-year-old female. There was a history of strong menorrhagia managed by OBGYN with hormones for 2 months and blood transfusions. No baseline investigation except hemogram and baseline LFTs were done, which were normal. She required 6 to 7 transfusions in 1 month. But after the end of the month, she presented with muscle hematomas and malina. There were no other clinical findings when we examined the patient. And these were the values. When we did the workup, we always do PTPTT as a basic workup in any bleeding patient or whenever there is a suspicion. The hemoglobin was low, TLC platelet was normal, LFTs were normal, creat was normal, PT was normal, but PTT was 106 by 33. And when we did the factor VIII levels, it was less than 1%. She is a female. She cannot be hemophilia A unless, but we did the factor VIII inhibitor and it had a very high titer factor VIII inhibitor, which is an acquired inhibitor. We immediately got a PET scan done. We showed a colonic mass. A colonoscopy and histobiopsy was done, which revealed a diagnosis of high-grade non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. So the final diagnosis became high-grade NHL with acquired inhibitor to factor VIII. We treated the patient with R-CHOP 6 cycles. She is doing very well. With the first cycle itself, the menorrhagia stopped. The factor VIII inhibitor reversed, and she became negative for factor VIII inhibitor. So imagine a 43-year-old female presenting with menorrhagia. I won't blame an OBGYN person for not doing or not thinking of this diagnosis. But the key was she did not have coagulation profile done. Sonography was done. Sonography of uterus was done, which was normal. Routine hemogram platelet was done, which was normal. But here the key was with coagulation profile. And let me honestly tell you, acquired inhibitor is not so rare. Many times it is missed and it is thought quite late. So it was again a biological mechanism which created an antibody. And this antibody caused the problem in coagulation pathway, factor VIII drop down. And once you start treating the underlying cause, you have the disappearance of acquired inhibitor to factor VIII. The commonest causes of acquired inhibitor are malignancy, autoimmune condition, pregnancy, and old age. Recently, we had a gentleman, 85-year-old man, had an acquired inhibitor, and same time, he had a coronary artery stenosis, thrombosis. We had to stent him, and we did that with low dose of Hemlibra. There was no other cause found. We had ruled out all other causes for acquired inhibitor. The third mechanism is the chemical impact. And it is mostly by malignant cells. Because generally, the normal cells would not cause a chemical impact on the other system unless they are pathological. The physiological chemical impacts, the nature has provided, the system has provided, and the harmony is going on. But whenever the malignancy sets in, the chemical composition of the blood can change. It can secrete something like paraproteins, it will secrete cytokines, it will secrete more interleukins. And the three areas, they're quite common, the renal involvement, the bone involvement, and the cardiac involvement. A person suddenly coming up with cardiac arrhythmias, if you see that there is elevated proteins, think of myeloma-associated amyloidosis involving the heart. And they are commonly seen in plasma cell dyscrasias and amyloid. Now, cardiac MRIs are available. It's a great investigation to do. As an investigation, we are working up for arrhythmias. Nearly 50 to 60% of cardiac involvements can present as arrhythmia and may have underlying malignant causes in blood. There are a lot of genetic causes in pediatric age group which change the impact. And some of the common things are something like PIDs, primary immune deficiencies. They have a genetic defect. Normal immunoglobulin proteins are not produced. They are more susceptible to infections. So a child in the infantile age group below age of 1 year coming back with recurrent infections at various sites, a genetic condition, PID, or other related conditions have to be ruled out in this age group. Immunological impact is the classic example is vasculitis. It is originated by T cells and B cell mediated. We know today there is a loss of self-recognition, and that's why the autoimmune conditions impact the body. Why this loss of self-recognition happens, that we don't have the answer. It leads to vascular injury, and to the injured vascular endothelium, the cellular component of blood is going to react differently. And this vascular injury is actually caused by the cellular component of blood. With this lethal combination, we know that there's so much of various manifestations possible with vasculitis or SLE-like syndrome. And it generally has a multi-system involvement. Again, recurrent infections in pediatric age group, we must think of immunological disorders like PID. They should not be missed, because if you have a PID and is causing immunological impact, it can be corrected by the stem cell transplant. In autoimmune conditions, now various immunosuppressants have come. A lot of JAK-STAT pathway inhibitors are available beyond ruxolitinib, which have shown great impact in the management of autoimmune conditions. The commonest group of mechanisms or systems involved is the renal system and SLE group of disorders. These immunological impact is generally combined with biological impact, and biology and immunology goes hand in hand. So this is the next case. A 23-year-old female presented with altered sensorium over 2 days and on admission had convulsions. MRI brain was normal. And these were the investigations. Hemoglobin 4.2, TLC 2000, platelet count 14,000, elevated bilirubin, HGOT, HGPT mildly elevated, PTA-PTT normal, but PBS showed schistocytes. So again, it immediately clicked the diagnosis. We sent off the ADAMTS 13, which was not detected. ANA was strongly positive. DSDNA was strong positive. There was low C3, C4 complement level. ESR was high. CRP was high. The bone marrow was done in view of the pancytopenia just to make sure that there was nothing else. Bone marrow was relatively normal with mild hemophagocytosis. So the final diagnosis was made is TTP with CNS involvement with nephritis. Please keep in mind, if patient presents with a CNS involvement, altered sensorium, convulsions with normal MRI, please ask your lab person to look for the schistocytes. Very good 5-part differentials do give a signal of schistocyte in the sample. But even today, still the most important test is to pick up schistocytes in the PB smear by a trained pathologist. Once you see the schistocytes, the diagnosis is very easy. So we made the final diagnosis of TTP with CNS and renal involvement at autoimmune cytopenia and SLE. Immediately, the patient was supported with plasma exchange. She underwent 6 plasma exchange with SLED for first 4 days. She was given rituximab, methylprednisolone, and endoxifen. And she is again doing well. She is following regularly. She will have a manifestation more than 2 years are over. Luckily, she is on a minimal dose of oral steroids and doing extremely well. So again, CNS becomes a target. And the clue here comes primarily from the microscopy and schistocytes. And very smoothly, you can keep monitoring schistocytes. Over a period of time, when she came out of this, we again repeated her ADAMTS 13 levels and they're normal. Her ANA has come down. The C3, C4 complement levels have normalized, ESR has normalized, and we are just following her with a very low dose of steroid continued in this patient. Next case is a 30-year-old male, again altered sensorium over 2 days and convulsions. Again, similar kind of hemogram, 4.2 hemoglobin, TLC 1000, platelet 4000. Rest of the blood investigation normal, LDH was very high. LDH was very, very high. Schistocytes were absent, B12 levels were normal. CT brain we immediately did, that was normal. bone marrow was consistent with aplastic anemia. And as expected, MRI brain showed cortical vein thrombosis. We immediately ran the PNH clone. The clone 1 and 2 was positive. So final diagnosis we made was paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria with cortical vein thrombosis. And he had aplastic marrow. He also underwent a MASH-related donor alloSCT and doing well. So two similar cases, similar age groups, similar hemogram. In one, LDH very high. Both the patients had very high LDH. One patient had absent cystocytes and other patient had cystocytes present. Immediately the diagnosis changed, the management changed. The presentation was really, really the same. PNH is a very complex disease and it is known to present with either a hemolytic anemia component alone or a pancytopenia or with the thrombosis. And a lot of cellular, biological and vascular interactions with PNH blood. And that leads to these problems. But again, allogeneic stem cell transplant is curative in this patient. He has completed more than a year and has normalized his hemogram, he's off immunosuppression, there is no evidence of GVH and is doing well. I am going to briefly touch upon three conditions. One is multiple myeloma. Multiple myeloma has physical, biological, chemical, and immunological impact. There is an extreme immune paresis. There is a paralysis of normal immunity in multiple myeloma and can present with bad respiratory or CNS infections. They would need a support initially with immunoglobulins. So this is a separate talk by itself. So I kept everything empty. But the viscosity changes, the blood flow changes, the blood rheology changes, the plasma cells are primary immune cells. They have paracrine and autocrine function. It has got a chemical impact. And it's a very fascinating disease, the way multiple myeloma affects the other system. Renal involvement, spontaneous fractures, cardiac involvement, CNS involvements are very common with multiple myeloma. And the clue is with simple tests like total proteins. Whenever you are doing a workup, ask for a total protein as a in the first go, because the albumin globulin ratio is going to give a very important clue. The second group of disorders is acute leukemias. Sometimes acute leukemias may present only with joint pains, and they may be treated as arthritis, some kind of arthritis. Many a times RA factor is negative, but still patients are given steroid. And recently we had a patient who had received steroids for nearly 3 months with a couple of weeks of methotrexate, who had only presented with joint pains. At presentation, total count was 18,000. No blasts were reported, but it was not with us, it was managed outside. But young patients coming with joint pains, please, please keep a diagnosis of acute lymphatic leukemia in mind and avoid empirical use of steroids. May present with bleeding per rectum. We have seen enough times acute myeloid leukemia presenting as per rectal bleeding. There is many times piles or hemorrhoids because the normal mucosal integrity is lost in because of AML. We had seen the patients being operated by surgeons without doing hemogram PTPTT, just piles is to be operated. Why investigate? Bleeding won't stop, then get referred to us, and we make a diagnosis of AML. EPTT before every surgery is very, very important test, whether it is a small surgery or a big surgery. Again, pleural effusions can happen in acute leukemias. In our country, TB is very common. People do pleural effusion, they do the tap, the lymphocytes are seen, they may actually be lymphoblasts. Proteins are elevated, exudative pleural effusion, empirical ATT is started, and we miss the diagnosis of leukemia because peripheral blood can be normal initially, especially with high-grade lymphomas. Avoid transfusion before workup is done, and this is very important for pediatric age group. Because small children, even blood is a good source of steroid. And always ask for a PBS review by a trained pathologist or hematologist. Again, sickle cell disease is a unique genetic disorder. It's a single point mutation disease, but has diverse presentation. I have not seen any genetic disorder, like, but sickle cell disease, where, which has a single point mutation. Every sickle cell disorder has the same mutation at position 6, but presentations can be diverse. There are now 4 varieties of sickle cell disease: African variety, Saudi Arabian variety, Indian variety, and lot not. It can present as stroke in young age group or even in middle age group. Acute chest syndrome, where the presentation is respiratory. Renal failure is not unknown. Bone pains and avian of femur are quite common with sickle cell disease and basically the sickling crisis. Many undiagnosed homozygous sickle cell disease patients, females, present with recurrent miscarriages. Undiagnosed pulmonary hypertension, venous thrombosis, or CVST, it is important to rule out sickle cell disease in a country like this. It is very important to rule out sickle cell disease if the patient is presenting as a pediatric patient or a young adult. Don't imagine that a genetic condition has to present in first decade of life. That's not true. That's not true. It can present in any stage of life. So to summarize, any system involvement can be the first manifestation of hematological disorder. And unless our antennas are high and alert, it can be very misleading. As a first investigation, we always do CBC with good examination of PBS, renal function test, LFT, LDH, PT, APTT. As a mandatory upfront testing, we call it a day one testing. We always collect extra EDTA, extra plane, and citrate tubes. But whenever you collect citrate tubes, you have to separate the plasma and freeze the plasma below minus 40. Because suddenly, if you want to give blood transfusion, plasma transfusion, you can't do IDMTS 13 level on a post-transfuse sample. So you have to have enough samples taken before you start treatment, especially transfusion. Please keep in mind, every low platelet count is not ITP. It can be TTP. And always have a high degree of suspicion and avoid empirical steroids. So our body is like a well-synchronized opera. And blood, I think, is the phantom of this opera. With this, I will conclude my talk. And thank you, Seema, for giving this tough topic. I've tried to do some justice, but I'm sure there are a lot of lacunes in this presentation. And I don't think this presentation can ever be complete. Thank you all.
Thank you, Shashi, for making it more easy. Like, I know it is a very difficult and a very vast subject, and not possible to brief it in 30 or 40 minutes of talk. It requires a lot of interaction also. Since there are right now no questions, I would like to know from you. You have already summarized, but if patient is not affording, what minimum test you would like to do to pick up the hematological disorder in patient presenting with the systemic?
See, basically, I would always do at least hemogram and do a very good PBS.
Yes.
And at least do, suppose it's a renal involvement. Suppose patient has presented as a renal failure, at least do proteins to rule out the multiple myeloma-like situation. At least do urine albumin creatinine ratio or collect urine, because it can be renal amyloidosis.
Yes.
But basically, we need certain basic tests when we want to rule out these hematological disorders. But again, the system which is being presented, that evaluation has to be done.
Yeah.
At least LDH is a very important
thing. Should be seen by the trained pathologist, and rest of the things like minimum investigations you have mentioned in the summary. If patient is not affording, at least should be done in a government setup or trust or wherever he can get it done at the minimal cost.
I think LDH is a very important test, which is many times missed by physicians and surgeons.
Yes.
LDH is a very important test to give a clue.
So one more question I wanted to ask you. You have shown in that slide that for TTP, you have sent ADAMTS 13 level. Just wanted to know, where do you get the ADAMTS 13 level? were done, because sending the sample on dry ice and getting report, it's there is a time lag, and we never wait for TTP patients.
Yeah, we don't
plasma exchange. Where do you send this?
No, see, right now in Pune, one lab in KM Hospital Pune has always been doing for last few years. Now even we have set up the LMTS 13 and we are standardizing.
Mm. Thank you so much, Dr. Shashi Apte, for sparing valuable time. I know he's a very busy person. He has a busy practice. Apart from busy practice, he is involved in many activities like hemophilia and other academic activities, which make him keep him busy throughout the day, and he has never said no for this conference, and this year also he is able to make it in spite of his busy schedule. Thank you very much, Shashi.
Thank you, Seema, for inviting me, and all the best for your remaining program. Bye, Seema. Bye everyone. Thanks for your kind attention.
Thank you very much. And now we are moving for a third presentation. Now the topic is different. Now, hematological presentations in having underlying malignant solid organ disorder. So for that, we have with us Dr. Shirish Alurkar, who is trained in Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai, and currently he's a director, medical oncology, Apollo CBCC, Ahmedabad, ESMO certified medical oncologist and DNB teacher medical oncology. So over to you, Dr. Alurkar.
Good afternoon, everybody. Thanks, Dr. Seema. I think this is my first time attending your conference as a faculty. Maybe I didn't attend even as a attendee as such. If I may share the screen, okay. Is it visible, the full screen?
Yes, sir.
Yes, visible.
Yeah, so again, thanks for inviting me. When Dr. Seema called me a few weeks back and gave me this topic, I said, okay, it's very easy. Seems to be quite easy. I can do it. I accepted the topic. Then I realized, did I make a mistake by accepting it? Because when I tried to look for the literature and sat down to make some slides, I realized it's a very hodgepodge sort of literature available as far as the hematological manifestation in solid tumors are concerned, which is my focus of talk today. And I will not be talking on the liquid tumors. So I had to really scratch my head, get references from here, there. We don't have a fixed textbook where we define one chapter on the hematological manifestations. I was also a little awed because when I saw the list of faculty, I thought, oh my God, these are all very expert hematologists. What would I, a medical oncology who doesn't really treat hemat problems, do here? But she also told me that don't worry about the management, because we are better than you in managing. So don't be concerned about the management of the hemat disorders. Just tell the manifestation. So that is what I will do in my short talk on the hematological manifestations of solid tumors. So the manifestations commonly which we see are anemia, which is there in almost any malignancy, be it a solid tumor or a liquid tumor. Cytopenias, we see in thrombocytopenia, leukopenia, or even pancytopenia. Bleeding disorders are known, and there is also the evidence of thrombosis, which could be something like a serendipity, and that is where we find some tumor hiding in the body. So if I just focus on the anemia, it is one of the commonest hematological manifestations in solid tumors. The incidence variously has been described to be about 20 to 50% of cases at diagnosis, and more so in Indian patients because they already have some pre-existent anemia because of nutritional deficiencies. And as the patient goes on treatment, almost 60 to 80%, depending on the type of treatment, the intensity of the treatment, they develop anemia related to cancer treatment. The effects of anemia on cancer patients, obvious, their fatigability, their weakness, their breathlessness. They tend to have a negative approach to cancer. There's a delay in initiating therapy, or maybe there'll be a delay in subsequent chemotherapy cycles, and poor quality of life, a poor response to radiation therapy and chemotherapy, which are all very well-established facts, and a number of literature is there to support this statement. So if I go to the causes of anemia, there are some direct causes which are due to the cancer itself because of the volume of the sheer volume of the disease itself leads to anemia. And there are certain indirect effects, even if it's a small tumor, for example, a small cell carcinoma in the lung, it can release certain factors which cause anemia. And that could be an effect of treatment, which I would not really talk much about that. So the direct effect of tumor could be a GI bleeding. In fact, when we have a patient with anemia, and if there is a fecal occult blood positivity, we have to look for the GI tract. And in case of a female, we have to, of course, look for the genitourinary system, especially the endometrium or the cervix, which is one of the commonest malignancies in our Indian subset of patients. Most of these bleeding disorders lead to iron deficiency, and these are the features. I will not go into the detail what investigations we do here. And that could be an intratumoral rupture or a bleed, especially when the tumor is large and undergoes necrosis. And when some of the blood vessels just rupture and there's a sudden increase in the size of the tumor. There could be some direct effects like some cancers like hepatocellular cancers, liver metastasis. I will not go into the list. It's a very exhaustive list and you all may not be really interested in reading the names. There could be a generalized bleeding would be because of thrombocytopenia. And this associated bleeding from treatment could be, and that could be also bone marrow suppression. Tumor-associated immune thrombocytopenia also known occur, and these patients can also present with DIC. Anemia could also because of bone marrow infiltration, which is more common we see, and especially in conditions like prostate cancer, when there is bone metastasis, which can be seen on a routine PET scan, even extensive metastatic breast cancer, they can have compromised bone marrow reserves and some rare cases of gastric carcinomas. These are very indirect effects. I would not go into the details like microangiopathic hemolysis and autoimmune. Very rarely we see in our patients here. So sometimes in cases of small cell lung cancers and maybe some prostate or gastric cancers. But thymoma is one subset where they have a large retroperitoneal tumor. Many times we think that it could be a metastatic germ cell tumor or could be a lung cancer or any other malignancy or a mediastinal primary B cell lymphoma. But we have to rule out thymoma, and in some cases, these are associated with pure red cell aplasia. The incidence of PRCA in patients with thymoma was ranging from 5 to 15%, and the treatment obviously is to it's a surgery, that is thymectomy. Anemia from treatment, basically, I would not go into detail, but most of the drugs, including the alkylating drug, the good old alkylating agents, the mitomycin, any oxidant damage to the mature hematopoietic cells, even simple drugs like cisplatin, oxaliplatin, and the not so toxic, apparently, which people believe that they are just tablets, the last line, like gefitinib, erlotinib, lenvatinib. These are all small tyrosine kinase inhibitors, small tablets, but they do have great impact on the marrow reserves, leading to anemia, even pancytopenia. Surgery, of course, would lead to nutritional deficiencies when there is a major compromise of the GI tract in the GI malignancy, or if there is a cytoreductive surgery for, say, C ovary, where the surgeon has to do a considerable amount of intercellular resection. It does lead in long term to B12 deficiency or even iron deficiency anemias. Radiotherapy, if there is multiple bone metastasis where the bone marrow itself is compromised, for example, in a prostate case, a prostate cancer case, we find that the marrow itself is compromised by osteoblastic metastasis. And over and above that, when the patient develops some fracture or some wedging, then we give radiotherapy. So that further enhances the suppression of the bone marrow. So the basic pathology in a cancer-related anemia or CRA is usually it's a hypoproliferative anemia, and it is usually normochromic normocytic, with a low retic count, a low or a normal iron levels, and reduced iron binding capacity. The ferritin is normal or increased with increased iron storage. That's one of the features of a cancer-related anemia. There is not really much of an iron deficiency leading to cancer-related anemia, but there is a defect in the iron handling capacity in patients with cancer. The other features could be a bone marrow erythroid hypoplasia. And one of the hallmarks, it is said that there is an inappropriately low EPO levels related to the degree of anemia, provided, of course, we rule out the renal causes. So that's one of the hallmarks of the CRA. is just a diagrammatic representation. We just focus on the central part of the presentation, that is the anemia secondary to cancer. It is most commonly due to a tumor infiltration and could be rarely because of hemolysis or even some cutaneous bleeding. So what is peculiar in Indian patients over so many years of practice? I've seen that some patients, they have pre-existent iron and B12 deficiency, which is quite high. I think you people will know the exact incidence in the Indian patients. What is the incidence of iron or B12 deficiency? But this all basically boils down to the dietary habits. For example, vegetarians who are totally don't eat non-veg, over a period of time, they develop B12 deficiency. So we have to factor in that also when we try to evaluate the reason for anemia. It could be secondary to any GI infection. The GI infections are because poor quality of water. I'll just explain what I mean by that. Anyone, what we call thela foods. There are people who have a lot of habit of eating outside foods. So, and then they consume this poor hygienic food and leads to amoebiasis and parasitic infections and ultimately leads to anemia. The poor quality of water, nowadays we don't see much here because of the advent of all those RO machines and whatnot. But when I was going to Junagadh, which is part of the Saurashtra, the old homes there, they had what is called the donkeys. Now they're underground tanks just below the houses, the old houses. And that is where they store their water for the whole year because the water scarcity. And they consume that water for even for drinking water. And these water has been shown to have a lot of parasites and a lot of amoebiasis. So ultimately it leads to the infection. So we have to really know how the patient is living, what is the lifestyle of the patient before treating the patient. Now there are certain regional ethnic differences which I found especially in my part where I practice. I don't know in other parts of the country, especially thalassemia is very common, or not so very common, but yes, it is common in the Lohana community in Saurashtra part of Gujarat. So there could be a pre-existing thalassemia with a persistent low hemoglobin. We investigate for some cause why the hemoglobin is low. And ultimately we come to the conclusion that there is possibly a thalassemia and investigate that way. So these are all regional differences which we have to really factor in when we treat a patient with anemia in solid tumors. It may not be directly related to the tumor itself. Is it clinically relevant? Yes, as I mentioned in the previous slides, it increases the fatigability, reduces the quality of life. And as far as I'm concerned, it will reduce the efficacy of the chemotherapy, which I offer to the patient, or even the radiotherapy. So these are the general guidelines. So we'll go to the pancytopenia. So pancytopenia in solid tumors is, again, not very common, I would say, but it involves the involvement of the bone marrow and leads to severe infections. And sometimes we cannot start the treatment of the chemotherapy. For example, if there's a metastatic CA prostate with extensive marrow involvement, patients present with pancytopenia, it's difficult to start the treatment in such cases. It leads to fatigue. There is possibly also bleeding because of thrombocytopenia and various constitutional symptoms. So all of these have a negative impact on the treatment. And ultimately, it's a negative prognostic feature for the progression of disease also. I think I would dwell on the pure red cell nucleus. I won't waste your time on this. Polycythemia, yes, in some cases we see especially paraneoplastic syndromes and where the hemoglobin is high, hematocrit is high. And especially in some cases like small cell lung, you find in hepatocellular carcinoma, RCC, renal cell carcinoma. These are some very rarely described in sort of anecdotal in some cases, I would say. The treatment obviously is surgical removal of the tumor. We don't, unless there is of course symptom due to the polycythemia, when we may go for the other specific therapies. Leukocytosis in solid tumors, not much, mainly as a part of a leukemoid reaction with the counts hovering around 40 to 50,000. And there are various growth factors like GCSF, maybe some interleukins, which tend to stimulate the marrow. But let me say, this is very rare. We don't see much of leukocytosis in solid tumors. Thrombocytosis is again very rare. Platelet count usually more than 4,50,000. It can be seen in sarcoma, GI, malignancies, lung, breast. But again, it's not very common. And it usually is a poor prognostic feature. These patients tend to have thrombosis and ultimately lead to compromise in the efficacy of the treatment. There is delay of treatment of the cancer. So there are certain for this, whenever there's a bleeding, that could be a non-invasive local treatment, which includes pressure, maybe dressing, or even invasive treatments like embolization, endoscopic procedures, etc. VTE, which is one of the other feature which we found many times, it is like a serendipity. We find patient presence with lower limb, you know, thrombosis, deep vein thrombosis, then retrospectively find some solid tumor somewhere. As far as the stats are concerned, a 12-month cumulative incidence of VTE is about 3%. Some literature says 0.5 to 1 to 2%, but as a general figure, it's about 3%. And this is about 9-fold higher than the general population. So it is definitely high. And the active cancer, whenever the cancer is active without treatment, it accounts for about 20% of overall incidence of VTE. And this has been corroborated in the global anticoagulant registry, that is the Garfield VTE registry. I think all of you are conversant with a large study, more than 10,300 patients. They found that the overall mortality was about 9.7 months in 6 months. And 54%, more than 50% of all the deaths were related to the cancer. So it is definitely a negative prognostic feature, and usually we counsel the patient in that way. Pathophysiology, it's basically the activation of the coagulation pathway and the thrombotic patients, thrombotic process in cancer patients compared to the general population. There's abnormal production of a tissue factor by the cancer cells, which leads to activation of the coagulant cascade, especially activation of factor 10. And there could be also additional secretion of other pro-coagulant factors with stimulation of factor 10A. These are all pro-coagulant pathways. There could be a pathway which suppresses the basically leads to fibrinolysis, and there is an inhibition of the fibrinolytic pathway by the inhibition of the plasminogen activator, inhibitor 1. So this is shown in this diagrammatically in this cartoon. And we, although the Corona score is there to detect the risk of developing thrombosis, in a clinical practice, we don't really use this much. And basically, the score, as all of you know, it's based on the site of the tumor, the pre-chemotherapy platelets, the hemoglobin level, etc. And in routine practice, we don't really jot down or we don't really note down, as for example, we note down the performance status according to ECOG or WHO category. We don't really note down this in our routine practice. The incidence of VTE depends on the various types of cancers, and significantly pancreatic, I was surprised, mesothelium is the second highest incidence of DVT, especially venous thromboembolism, especially with therapy, because there are certain drugs available for mesothelium which predispose to VTE. So I was a little surprised when mesothelium was second on the list. If you see, if you go down the list, you see the incidence of VTE, especially in leukemia, is almost we say 1/3 the incidence in pancreatic cancers. That's how the incidence is in solid tumors. Risk factors, you can't really say there's one factor for leading to VTE. There are multiple factors coming into play. For example, it is the type of tumor. As I mentioned in my previous slide, stage, the more advanced the disease, the more the incidence of VTE, whether the patient has received previous hormonal therapy or chemotherapy. For example, a patient of breast cancer may have received hormonal therapy in the previous 5 years and may have stopped. And now she comes after, say, after another 4 or 5 years with a recurrence of disease. But many times we forget that the patient has received hormonal therapy previously. So this also has to be considered. Surgical interventions do increase. More the surgical, more extensive the surgery. For example, cytoreductive surgeries, which we do now in ovarian cancers or intestine cancers, do predispose to VTE. And as a routine, the surgeons use prophylaxis for that. This, of course, it correlates to the length of anesthesia, the age, immobilization. All these are all correlated with each other. If there is an indwelling venous catheter, so obviously the chances of VTE are high. As I mentioned, it depends on the site and the type of the cancer. So very high risk would be the stomach pancreatic cancer. I would add mesothelioma here. And high risk would be lymphomas, lung, gynecological cancers. And low risk would be the head and neck, luckily, because head and neck in India is the highest, largest, I mean, the maximum amount of solid tumors which we see. Luckily, the incidence of VTE is low, otherwise it would have created more havoc in the population. The workup, all of you are very conversant. Basically, we look at the physical examination, occult fecal blood to rule out any GI malignancies. If it's a female, we look at the gynecological part. In men, we have to rule out urological issues. And this also entails doing an upper GI or a lower GI workup. And it could be corroborated with a CT scan or MRI or even a PET scan, depending on what we find out in the initial tests. Treatment aim, I'm writing the aim, I'm not going to the dosage. Basically, we want to prevent fatal pulmonary embolism and recurrent pulmonary embolism, which would compromise the survival and the treatment of our cancer patients. And we have to prevent the long-term complications of VT, which are the post-thrombotic syndrome and the chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. So whom to coagulate is a thing. Basic bottom line is those patients who are relatively immobile, who are undergoing extensive surgery, they are the patients who really need anticoagulation. And there are certain drugs which we have to use which predispose to coagulation. And therefore, in such cases, we have to use anticoagulants. Most of them are the low molecular weight heparins or the oral forms. I think this is the last slide. I hope I have given adequate justice to the topic, and it was a short presentation. Thank you very much, Dr. Seema.
Thank you very much, Dr. Alukar, and for a good message with emphasis on, even though patients have hematological presentations like anemia or thrombosis or bleeding, low platelet, one must actually should evaluate to find out the underlying cause, and that underlying cause may be a solid organ malignancy. And unless you tackle the root cause, the patient is not going to respond. It is going to be just a time over the that time. So it's thank you very much sparing your valuable time.
Thank you.
Thanks. So we will go ahead with the next presentation. And next presentation is updates in the sickle cell disease. And I'm going to present it in next 30 minutes. Just give me some time. I'm not able to Minimum. ऑब्स्ट्रक्ट करते हैं.
मोबाइल से मेल मेरे को फॉरवर्ड करो, मैं प्रेजेंट करता हूँ मुझे लैपटॉप जिससे बी देयर फॉर 2 मिनट्स.
आई एम गेटिंग सम प्रॉब्लम इन इन गेटिंग इट ऑन स्क्रीन. जस्ट बी देयर, आई विल बी देयर.
So there is some issue with Dr. Seema's internet. Just wait for a while. Manish, laptop line on. You can see.
Sorry for trouble, but we are getting some problem with the internet. I'll be there in 2 minutes' time.
sorry for the interruption, but now we are back with the proper internet connection, and in next 20 minutes, in next 40 minutes, I am going to just brief you about the management of the sickle cell disease, how it has progressed over a period of time. So as you all know, that sickle cell disease is a significant health burden in India, because there is a largest concentration of tribal population in India. So this is the map of India, where the sickle is very common, and especially this I'm practicing in Baroda, and because Baroda is in proximity with the Panchmahal, and it is also in the proximity with the tribal areas of Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan, we get a lot of patients from all this area for tertiary care. And as Dr. Shashi Apte already mentioned, that it is a very amazing thing that it's a single mutation, just one change of the amino acid, glutamic acid to valine, and we get a variable presentation. So all over the world, the mutation is single, but we get the heterogeneous presentation all over the world. So in 2021, now there are a lot of things have changed over a period of time, and we are going to talk about how we have changed as far as pathophysiology understanding is concerned, VOC management is concerned, what are the current conventional therapies, and what are the unmet needs in spite of conventional therapies available for sicklers, and what are the novel targeted therapies which are now approved for treatment of sickle cell disease, and curative options for the sickle cell disease. So first is pathophysiology. So over the period of time, our understanding had changed from the old school of thought that vaso occlusive crisis usually happens because of the occlusion of the sickle cells in the vessels, and this sickling occurs because of the hypoxia. There is a polymerization of the sickle hemoglobin, which blocks the cell, blocks the vessel, and results into VOC. But over a period of time, the understanding has improved in the sense that it is not only the sickle cells, but there are a lot many things happening, cytokine release, various enzyme release, where the endothelial activation, there's a lot of role of adhesion molecules, and with these adhesion molecules, there is a lot of role of platelet neutrophils also in contribution for VOC. So by knowing the this pathophysiology more, we understand that we are more targets available for treatment of VOC. So these are the various targets which we can aim for to get the control on the sickle cell crisis or VOC. So next is VOC management. Why we are more concentrating on VOC management is, in sickle cell, the VOC management is the main thing which is going to prevent the organ damage. And if you see this slide, that VOC is like in thrombosis, we see it is a tip of iceberg like that. VOC is a tip of the iceberg. What we see is the actual patient presenting with the pain, and it is because of that many patients comes to the hospital to take treatment of acute or chronic complications related to VOC. But what we are not seeing and causing the damage to the end organ is silent damage, which occurs during the period between two VOCs, or happening whenever there is not even pain, but the milder kind of VOC is happening and hampering the blood supply to vital organs, causing chronic complications. So we should aim not only to relieve pain, but to relieve all these minor occlusions also, and the basic aim of the VOC should be prevent organ damage. So this slide will show that now we know that VOC actually has a four-phase prodromal initial phase established followed by resolving phase, and it's spread over the 8 to 10 days. And it's actually, if you treat this patient in a first phase, like a prodromal phase or initial phase, it is going to help in relieving not only pain, but preventing many complications. So this is a nice guidance which says that whenever patient comes with the pain or VOC, give some ear to the patient's complaint, because they give a lot of information on why VOC has happened, whether there is an underlying inflammation, infection, or something else which has triggered a VOC. Should be definitely evaluated properly to get over the VOC quickly. Critical pain in acute, in emergency department only, and provide analgesia within 30 minutes to get the adequate effect. So the, in short, the management strategy should be give painkiller, not only painkiller, which consists of the pharmacological and non-pharmacological agents, but give adjunctive therapy, which is a non-pharmacological, give adequate hydration, maintain oxygenation, at least SpO2 should be more than 95%, and PCV transfusion only in selective patients. Like PCV transfusion is not a treatment of PSU or not a treatment of pain, because if patient's hemoglobin is normal and give PCV, it is not going to help in relieving pain. On the contrary, by increasing viscosity, the patient might end up with a more problem. So what are the current conventional therapies available to prevent the VOCs and to prevent the organ damage in the patients of sickle cell disease? So these are the things available. Either you can have now in government setups, like there are lot many actions or lot many programs going on at the government level which are trying to cover the sickle cell disease patients, and they give minimum possible things at least for your cost, like hydroxyurea, vaccination, supportive care, and transfusion, also PCV transfusion. Like I have seen in Gujarat, at least they all, if patient has a diagnosis of sickle cell disease, HPLC available with him or her, they get PCV blood free of cost from any blood bank. So these are the minimum standard treatment which are available for patient in government setup as well as in the private setup. So as far as hydroxyurea is concerned, its efficacy has been very well established by various studies, and this was a landmark study which has shown that all the patients who were enrolled on the hydroxyurea, they did very well as far as bone pain is concerned, acute chest syndrome is concerned, and the mortality was reduced. The stroke incidence has also decreased. So as far as the efficacy of hydroxyurea is concerned, it has shown a great efficacy in the patient of sicklers, irrespective of whether their presentation was severe or milder syndrome. And as far as safety profile is concerned, hydroxyurea has proven that it is very safe in sickle cell disease patient, and follow-up of patients on hydroxyurea did not show a serious adverse event which actually results into stopping of the hydroxyurea. Only 10 to 20% patient might show some bad complications or intolerance which leads to stopping of the hydroxyurea. So the efficacy and safety of the hydroxyurea is very well proven, and it has shown a very good effect in those patients who have shown the the good efficacy. So if we have a good hydroxyurea available, vaccination is done in the government hospital, PCV or blood transfusion is available as a freely available and supportive care, then what is the need? What is the unmet need in sicklers? So unmet need in what I have analyzed over a period of time, we have almost more than 800 patients of sickle patients in our OPD having regular follow-up. And what we have seen on analysis of these patient data, that there is still some lacune in the awareness among the patients and medical fraternity. There are so many patients in the tribal region or rural region who needs actual information regarding the availability of treatment and the complications of treatment when they should reach to the hospital and take the treatment. Then the same is applicable for the reach out programs. Like these programs are many times are available at the state level or district level, and these patients are from the interior rural level. And we need, there are already government is doing a lot of work in having rural sickle care centers distributing a lot of medicine and care for this patient. But there is a lot of scope for having a systematic and organized way of reach out program to the rural tribal area, which will give the at least current established standard of care to maximum patients of sicklers. Then there are some limitations of the standard of care treatment. Like as I said, this hydroxyurea is a very good has got a very good efficacy and safety. But in spite of that, the benefit is seen in a hardly 50 to 60% of patients. Why? Because many times 40 to 50% patient, they do not adhere to the treatment because of it has to be taken daily. Oral treatment is sometimes it's a difficult for patient, and they try to take a drug holidays on their own. So that is the major problem, that adherence is a problem. Secondly, 10 to 20% patients show the intolerance to the drug. Some side effects like a fall in WBC platelet and hemoglobin may, and they do not even maintain their counts on reduction of the hydroxyurea dose, may be a reason we have to stop the hydroxyurea. Or sometimes it is a, in spite of the maximum tolerated dose, we are not getting a proper result, and we are, that is a failure to the treatment of hydroxyurea, which we get in a 10 to 20% of patients. Apart from that, because we have these 30 to 40% patients who need actually something better, we definitely have a need for a targeted therapy which can target this patient to get the actual result. And the best will be explore the curative treatment, which is doable, possible, financially possible in all patients. So we'll go one by one. So what are the challenges in the use of hydroxyurea? This has been very well published in this follow-up study of the risk and benefits of long-term hydroxyurea and sickle cell anemia. And it has shown that only 20% patients take regularly more than 15 years hydroxyurea. There are many patients who are not adhere. And those patients who do not adhere to hydroxyurea, they do not get the benefit of the hydroxyurea. And thereby, this slide very well shows that therapeutic benefit you will get only if drug is efficacious and patient is adherent to therapy. So because of the non-adherence and because of the small percent not having tolerance or small percent of patient not having response to the treatment, there are certain number of patients who do not respond to hydroxyurea. And because of that, even though hydroxyurea, vaccination, hydration, transfusion has made the life of sicklers easy, and definitely there is an improvement in the life expectancy in the sickle cell disease. If you see this graph from 1920 to 2000, definitely there is an increasing lifespan of the sickle cell disease, but still we are lacking, we are way behind the normal expectancy of the general population. So here comes the targeted drugs which will help in these patients, and US FDA has approved these three novel drugs for sickle patients. First is L-glutamine, which was got approval in July 2017, then Voxelotor in November 2019, and Crizanlizumab in November 2019. So first is a L-glutamine, which is an oral drug, and it reduces actually oxidative stress, and it has shown that the pain crisis has significantly decreased when glutamine is given orally to the sickle patient. It has also significantly reduced the hospitalization rate, and the serious adverse events were not seen significantly increased in patients of glutamine when compared to placebo. So in conclusion, the L-glutamine is an oral drug which can be taken as a 0.3 gram per kg per dose. It is given as a twice a day. More than 5 years of age and older patients can take this treatment, but it is contraindicated in critically ill patients. And since the long-term benefits are unclear, it's not very popular. Or again, it is an oral dose, and not only once, but it has to be taken twice a day. Again, if adherence is an issue with hydroxyurea, that same issue will be there for the L-glutamine also, even though it is a targeted therapy. Then next is a Voxelotor, which got approval in 2019. It is again oral once a daily sickle hemoglobin polymerization inhibitor, and it has shown is good efficacy in trial data. It is basically beneficial for patients who have a drop in hemoglobin secondary to hemolysis, but it has not shown any reduction in the VOC. So in India, since we have a majority of patients showing VOC as a presentation, and very minority of patients has a presentation as a hemolysis, this drug may not be add much value to the treatment in addition to hydroxyurea. But third drug, which is a P-selectin inhibitor, is amazing, and I think it will definitely make a change in the life of sickle cell patients in India. So it is a P-selectin inhibitor, and if you see this diagram, it shows that in viso-occlusive crisis, what happens is there is a P adhesive molecules which get activated on the endothelium, and this endothelium leukocyte, RBC, sickled RBC, and platelet get attached. And because of this attachment of RBCs, WBCs, and platelets to P-selectin molecule, you get the occlusion of the vessel. Crizanlizumab is a P-selectin inhibitor, and by inhibiting this molecule, adhesion molecule, you are preventing the occlusion of vessel, irrespective whether patient has a sickled RBCs or not having sickle RBC. In spite of sickling occurring in the vessel, it will prevent the vessel occlusion. And the study was published in 2017 in the NEJM. And this is a sustained study, landmark study on crizanlizumab. It has shown the significant decrease in the annual rate of VOCs in patients who have received crizanlizumab 5 milligram per kg body weight. That there is a significant decrease in number of patients who were VOC free, not having a single VOC in 1 year. The number was much more higher than compared to placebo. And this again shows that the time to have a first VOC on crizanlizumab was increased when patient was on crizanlizumab 5 milligram per kg body weight. Time for a second VOC was also significantly increased. This shows that there's a significant decrease in annual days of hospitalization in this patient, because the VOC has decreased, because pain has decreased, and because organ damage related complications have decreased, the hospitalization has also significantly decreased in these patients. And it has shown that it works across all all the groups. Like here, it has shown irrespective of whether patient has a 5 to 10 crisis before starting crizanlizumab or 2 to 4, it works in both. It also works in all genotypes, irrespective of whether patient has a SS genotype or non-SS genotype, it will work in these patients also. And as far as serious adverse events are concerned, they are minimal, and it's not adverse serious events were seen in a increased number compared to placebo. The minor serious adverse events seen were the paresthesia, flu-like symptoms, or chest pain or some bone pain, and it was manageable with the simple paracetamol or some kind of painkiller, and usually this happens within 24 to 48 hours of infusion. So now we're moving to the curative treatment availability. The only curative treatment available for sickle cell disease is the hematopoietic stem cell transplant, and the indication for bone marrow transplant in sickle cell disease is those patients who are less than 20 years of age, who have a HLA matched donor available, and patient has a severe disease, like patient is getting recurrently admitted for a life-threatening complications. So that is why many times I have seen the whatever patients we are getting, these patients, whenever they are on the hydroxyurea, we are not getting these patients recurrent life-threatening complications. And because of that, many times, as patient has never seen life-threatening complication, when you tell them about the bone marrow transplantation, they are hesitant to go for such treatment because it is an extensive, expensive treatment, and it goes on for one and a half year. So those patients who have a very less severe, just milder form of symptom, they will definitely do well with the hydroxyurea, and they like to be very cozy with that oral treatment only. Even though you explain that this is curative, they many times are hesitant to accept this fact. And usually, if patient is having severe disease, having life-threatening complications, which might happen in 20 to 30% of patients, and 10% patient may be showing such kind of complication even on hydroxyurea, these patients should be definitely explained and pushed for the allogeneic bone marrow transplantation before severe organ damage occurs. So what are the limitations? What limitations we are finding? Like, I agree that 10 to 20% patients are definitely patients who should undergo transplant to get a cure from all this complication crisis and vaso-occlusive crisis-related complication. But what are the limitations we face when we explain this treatment to patient? So first and foremost important is non-availability of donor. Like if you go for HLA typing and matching, 20% of patient will have a 100% match HLA donor available. And out of that, those 20% who has a HLA match sibling donor available, then we have to find out whether they are clinically fit, whether organ damage is not there, whether financially they are going to make it, and then only we can take these patients for the transplant. So to overcome this this problem of non-availability of the donor, there are certain clinical trials going on the haploidentical transplant, but it is not yet a recommended therapy, and gene therapy is also there in pipeline, which might become a reality over a period of time. But till we get these two therapies available, we should go on with the current conventional therapy which is available. So before concluding lecture, I would like to show a few slides about the HOCC experience about sickle cell disease. We have more than 860 patients registered, and all of them are advised to take hydroxyurea, folic acid, B12, calcium, vitamin D3 if that is deficient. And what I have seen that approximately 60% patients are adherent to treatment, and on regular treatment, 40% are not taking on and off treatment. Pneumococcal vaccine is advised, but only 40% take the vaccine. 20 to 25% have breakthrough VOC in spite of good response sometimes, but they have a breakthrough basically, especially I have seen in the monsoon season. And 5 to 10% have a life-threatening complication in spite of showing good response to hydroxyurea through the rest of the time, but sometimes monsoon or some infection and suddenly going down everything and making them vulnerable to life-threatening complications. So I have a little experience on crizanlizumab also. There are total 8 patients on crizanlizumab, and all were actually on maximum dose of the hydroxyurea, but they were either not responding or having recurrent breakthrough VOCs, and that is where they were enrolled for the crizanlizumab. It was given in a dose of 5 mg per kg body weight in 100 ml NS over 30 minutes as a daycare procedure. The first two doses were given 2 weeks apart as a loading dose, and from third dose onward, it was continued as a every 4 weeks maintenance therapy. There were no infusion reactions we have observed, and post-infusion serious side effects were not seen. As I said, post-infusion second day or third day, sometimes patients come back with some pain, aches or fever, which was managed very easily with the paracetamol. So it's almost not 12, but now 24 weeks, we have a follow-up, and we have seen that there is a reduction in leukocytosis, thrombocytosis, and significant reduction in chronic pain between two VOCs. They are having a pain-free daily activities, and none of them had a VOC even in the monsoon season, which we had 2 months back. But still, we need to wait for 52 weeks to see an overall response. So I feel when hydroxyurea came into the launch and it came into the as a treatment in 1995, it was a boon for sicklers, because before that there was nothing available for sicklers except for the supportive therapy. It has shown a really great changes in the life of sicklers. But when there was a time that after for almost 20 years there was nothing new available for patients who did not respond to hydroxyurea, or who were having intolerance to hydroxyurea, or who were not willing to continue hydroxyurea daily for years together. And this launching of crizanlizumab, I feel as a hematologist, it's like a dream drug for sicklers, and it will be like game changer. Because why? Because it is a once a month, so there is no question regarding the adherence. Patient has to come only once a month to the OPD. There are no infusion related reactions, so it can be given at even PHC level. It is only 30 minutes, so patient doesn't have to take leave from his office or its work. There are no bone marrow suppression or other side effects are seen. So intolerance or is rarely seen. Then significantly reduction in recurrence of VOC has definitely made their life better, and it will definitely improve their work efficacy and their social interaction and their professional in their efficacy in professional work will also get reflected when the efficacy is when you have a significant decrease in the VOCs. So that I feel that it is going to be a very, very game changer in this patient. And I have used it in the 8 patients, I have seen that it brings back smile on the face of the patient and bringing back their normal life to whatever social life, professional life, everything going back to normal is always a dream for this patient. So in conclusion, hydroxyurea is still a standard of care in our country, and definitely vaccination supportive care is a backbone. Like if you give only hydroxyurea and don't cover the vaccine, cover the infection with vaccine, or not looking the hydration, that will not give a proper result. So with hydroxyurea, infection prevention, vaccination, supportive care with a good hydration is going to give a good result. Targeted therapies, targeted drugs can be used to decrease morbidity and mortality in certain patients where you feel that hydroxyurea is not working. allogeneic bone marrow transplantation is the only curative options which can be given for 10 to 20% of patients who have a severe disease and having HLA match donor available and finance is not problem. No organ damage can be definitely taken for a curative option. But majority of patients, 70 to 80%, who have a financial problem or who do not have a donor or who do not have a severe disease can do well with crizanlizumab with or without hydroxyurea. And that is, I feel, is a best possible treatment to prevent VOC and its complication in sickle cell disease in Indian scenario. And I would like to acknowledge my teacher, Dr. Shashi Apte, HOCC lab, and all sickle patients who are taking treatment at HOCC. And thank you very much for patient listening. I'm sorry for having hiccups and some internet problem in the beginning. And I hope you have enjoyed this presentation. And I'm willing to answer any question you have for sickles. So there is only one question in question box, so that is a cost of crizanlizumab. So with the patient assistance program, I think the one vial of crizanlizumab is 100 milligram and the cost is around 30,000. And I think the Novartis will be better people to this answer whether they can give it in a better rate to the patients who are not affording. And there are a lot of efforts have been made to make it available in the government setup, to make it freely available for all those needy patients. They are a tribal patient. They are not at all affording and they definitely need this drug. And that is why we are doing a lot of efforts to make it available at a government setup and to make it so that it will reach to all needy people. If there are no questions, we will conclude today's session. I would like to, I will conclude this day with saying thanks. Okay, so there is one more question, that role of crizanlizumab in preventing subclinical VOCs. So definitely those patients who are having VOCs without pain will be definitely taken care by crizanlizumab. I don't have a sub-analysis of that sustained trial showing the exact number of patients who were not having VOC and the subclinical these occlusions were prevented. But if you look at the their action, the action P selecting, if it is getting inhibited, it is going to prevent even subclinical VOCs. And that is what is the aim. Aim is to prevent the organ damage, and that can be definitely achieved with such kind of drug. So one more question. This way. So there's one question on what are the vaccination you recommend? So as far as vaccination is concerned, the data says that recommended vaccine is for pneumococcal. So we give Prevnar 13 for all patients, but definitely in my OPD, I recommend for HIV and meningococcal vaccine also, because in our patient, 50 to 60% of patients have a splenomegaly. And many times they come with the infarcts, splenic infarct and or splenic sequestration. And we might have to take them for an emergency splenectomy. So in that situation, it is always better to cover them with the all three vaccines, which we use for patients who undergo splenectomy. So these are the three vaccines we definitely recommend for patients who come for a regular follow-up. Then next question is, if patient have severe VOC crisis and with severe vomiting, should we, how we can give hydroxyurea to patient? So very good question, that if patient has a severe VOC and severe vomiting, then first thing is, in VOC, we always, first thing is, evaluate within half an hour, first you evaluate this patient, why this patient is having vomiting. So most common cause of vomiting in such patient when they come with the VOC is a underlying infection. So pinpoint infection, what kind of infection he is having, he or she is having. So target the infection therapy first. And once that infection get under control, you can restart the hydroxyurea. So you are absolutely right. When patient is having infection with vomiting, and your patient is not tolerating oral food, do not force them to take the hydroxyurea. First, maintain his hydration with the IV fluid, give appropriate antibiotic, and then definitely restart the hydroxyurea whenever it is possible and whenever patient tolerates the food. So L-glutamine, one question is, what is the role of glutamine? That actually reduces the oxidative stress, and thereby it prevents the vaso-occlusive related complications and pain. But as I said, when you compared it with the injectable crizanlizumab, L-glutamine is an oral treatment, and it has to be taken in a powder form morning and evening for lifelong. So it becomes a, again, there is a problem of again compliance. So like in hydroxyurea, we give it in a OD dose. So whatever 15 to 30 milligram per kg body weight hydroxyurea is given in a OD dose. But that also becomes a problem for patient. L-glutamine is also going to be a problem for patient. And again, when you compare hydroxyurea with L-glutamine, the L-glutamine cost is higher compared to hydroxyurea, and it is easy to manage. Whereas in L-glutamine, there are various studies have shown that its long-term efficacy has not been established. Whereas in hydroxyurea, it is now has robust data showing the 20-year, 30-year, you have a long-term data showing its efficacy and showing no long-term serious adverse events. So you compared when it is an oral drug, I would prefer hydroxyurea over L-glutamine. Only when the patient not responding to hydroxyurea, but wants the oral treatment, you can try for the L-glutamine. So the very good question is, should we give PCV to patient at HB of 9 gram percent with severe osteomyelitis with the hemolytic crisis? So as far as sickle cell disease patients are concerned, the PCV transfusion depends on what was his steady level. If the steady level hemoglobin is 8 or 9, this transfusion of PCV is not going to help. But if steady level hemoglobin was 11 and 12 and it has dropped down to 9, it might help, but never try to overdo the thing. We never allow transfusion to increase hemoglobin above 10 or 11, because beyond 11 or 12 gram percent, it will increase the viscosity. And by increasing viscosity, you are going to do more damage than benefit. Then there's a question, cardiac complications in sickle cell disease with VOC where we can't give IV fluids. Okay, so cardiac complication, like in VOC, sometimes I have seen young patients dying because of coronary artery, sudden coronary artery occlusion and death. But if you are asking me the cardiac complications like having LV failure and not able to give fluid, no problem, because in sickler we never overhydrate. So the message is never overhydrate. give adequate hydration. Like if patient, if you think your patient is having cardiac complication like LV dysfunction and you are not able to give IV fluid, ask them to take oral fluid. 60 ml per kg body weight per day is the requirement. So if patient is able to take it orally, no need to push IV fluid and make the cardiac condition worse thing. Any others? So one more question is, once patient develop hydroxyurea induced leukopenia, can we restart hydroxyurea in future once leukocyte count normalized? So yes, we can start, but then you have to find out at what dose patient has developed leukopenia, and secondly, when leukopenia happened, what was the problem? Was it because of the associated infection or any other, like sometimes viral infection, bacterial infection can cause a bone marrow suppression and that results into leukopenia and we are stopping the hydroxyurea. That is a other situation. But if you think that that leukopenia has happened because of hydroxyurea, then restart at a lower dose. Like if it has occurred with a 20 milligram per kg body weight dose, you start with the 10 milligram per kg body weight and then gradually increase over a period of time. And if it has happened because of some kind of infection, viral, bacteria, something like that, you can restart with the ORI. If a sickle patient come with the sputum positive, then how we can give AKT in case of sickle hepatopathy? So this applies to all those patients who have a liver problem, some kind of chronic liver disease, and we need to give AKT. I think this question should be addressed by the gastroenterologist. But to my knowledge, sickle hepatopathy, I have seen in Gujarat, I have seen hardly less than 5% patients who have a hepatopathy resulting into rise in enzymes or rise in bilirubin. All these patients who have an increased enzyme or bilirubin, they most of them have some underlying other causes of liver dysfunction like chronic alcoholism or hepatitis B infection, hepatitis C infection. So these are the CLD patients with the impaired liver function. And these patients usually, I don't take the decision of starting AKT, but I leave it to gastroenterologist to take decision. So this was, that was the last question. So we, even if you have any other question in your mind and you are not asked right now, you can definitely contact me on email info@hoccindia.com. Send your query and I will definitely would like to revert back as soon as possible. So with that, we conclude our day one session, and I'm grateful to all these big names in hematology and oncology, Dr. M.B. Agarwal, Dr. Shashi Apte, and Dr. Alurkar, for sparing their valuable time and enlightening us on various topics. And all of delegates, I thank that I know all of them are not very happy with the now digital or virtual conference. But in spite of they are having so much of overburden with the virtual meetings and not very happy with the such kind of conferences now and waiting for the in-person conference. In spite of that, they are sparing time from their routine activities and they're taking part in participating in such webinar. I'm really thankful to them also. And request all these delegates to join again tomorrow at 10:30 a.m. with the same link which has been sent to you to join today. So, so good night, Shubh Ratri, Shabba Khair, and stay healthy. And join us tomorrow again at 10:30 with the same link.